Testing, testing. It was a Thursday afternoon in October, this man says. The time was 5 o'clock. I was in the Funabashi district, making my last delivery of the day, bringing sake to an old client of mine, the Kuano family. I have entered their backyard 100 times, but that day I immediately knew something was wrong. I could feel it. I remember standing still for a moment and looking around. Suddenly, I caught a glimpse of something small climbing up the back wall. I remembered that I thought it was a monkey. The family dog seemed anxious. He wasn't barking. He was too uneasy to be barking. As I put down the sake, I also noticed that the dog's food had been knocked over. I don't know whether the dog did it or that other animal did it. I had the strangest feeling that something was amiss, but told myself that it was merely my imagination and wrote out the receipt.
私の日常生活は。Yes,
it was Thursday evening, says this neighboring resident. I was watching the news, and I had my sliding doors open, because it was pleasant weather that time of year. I heard a voice outside, a guy Jin's voice. I was surprised that someone would be in my garden, but then I decided it was probably the house next door. I was relaxing back into my chair when suddenly I caught a glimpse of what looked like a child. I called my son for help. Isn't that right?
You said, come here.
Do you remember what I said?
You said it was a funny little guy in the garden.
You tell the story.
What?
You tell the story.
No, you tell the story. You were closer than me.
She's the one who sends text messages to everybody, boasting.
He was closer than me. He was actually in the bathroom. Washing the dogs. The dogs are very protective. They jumped up out of the bath. This one started barking at the window. That is all we know, although we heard more later from other people. I went around the corner to buy some lunch, and the man in the shop had seen much more than me.
Between 9:30 and 10:30 a.m., the shop is very quiet. I was standing in the position I am standing in right now. I heard someone enter the shop. I looked up, saw a strange little man walk down the aisle towards me, examining the products carefully. There was something wrong about him. He was African, quite old, but the size of a small child, and he was wearing a strange hat. When he left, I ran into my house and got my video camera. For a while, I thought he was gone. Then I was sure I got a shot of him in the distance. Unfortunately, when I watch the tape, I don't really see anything at all. That's it.
As night fell on Tokyo and the weekend got underway, many more Japanese people would claim to have similar, strange encounters. Yoshio Ichimura runs a nighttime bar in downtown Goryamu, which some say panders to a high-class criminal clientele.
There are no drugs here, despite what people may have told you. Just men who work hard, having a good time. I was sitting at a table playing an old Japanese card game called Karuta. I was told there was a man who wanted to talk to me. I said that I didn't want to talk, but the doorman said I had to. He said he had never seen a man like this. I left the table and sat down in a booth, and they brought the man to see me. I couldn't believe it. He was only 3 feet tall, and there was something wrong with his face. Perhaps plastic surgery. But he was dressed immaculately. Perhaps Moroccan, Arabic. He wore a fez and a sharp pinstripe suit and sunglasses. He took a large Cuban cigar from one pocket and a gold lighter from the other and lit up. I was nervous and asked him what I could do for him. He said that he needed to buy guns. I was scared of him. I told him to leave. I tried to draw a picture of him afterwards on a napkin, but unfortunately it didn't look right. He didn't look like that. All sorts of crazy people come in here. They're private citizens and they do what they want. It has nothing to do with me. I know that he eventually found his guns, but he didn't find them in this club. We didn't want anything to do with him. We see a lot of weird characters, but this man was a little too weird.
Some Grahamu residents believe the small man spent a few days downtown. Others claim this is simply the area he sprang from. Most agree that he did approach cigarette manufacturer and reputed assassin Satoshi Kamata with a view to buying guns. Kamata would not talk to him, the story goes. Certainly, Kamata had no interest in talking to this documentary crew. Another reputed criminal, Hideo the Monk Sungana, was said to be more cordial and apparently suggested the little man try cocos.
The little African man came in looking for cocoa. It drank orange juice and also...
Okashi, Japanese. Snack. Rice. Chips. I'm making... cooking.
He ate quickly and drank his juice slowly. Coco was scared and wouldn't come out of the office. I took a photograph of it, but when the photograph was developed, there was nothing there. At first my friends thought I made it up, but people were seeing more little men. Some saw a Moroccan man, but this guy was African.
He wasn't African.
He wasn't Moroccan either. He had dark hair and was wearing a white suit and smoking a cigarette, and he looked lost. He was sort of scowling and bitching to himself, wasn't he?
Complaining, yes.
He was pissed off about something, all right. Yes, the little man in the white suit went in and just asked for guns. They took him to one of their chain of shops, I think. Yakuza sell guns to people who don't have a gun license. Yakuza will sell guns to anyone. They're the biggest organized crime syndicate in Japan. You don't mess around with them. They're very violent men. The Yakuza who lives in that building, he's missing a finger. And the Yakuza, that is punishment. But I think this guy cut it off himself to prove remorse to his boss for bad investments. Anyway, legend has it he was watching TV that Sunday night when the strange little creature just walked in. Even the Yakuza man was shocked. Everybody who saw those little men was shocked.
The creature asked if he could come in, if we were open. I said, okay. I just looked at it as business. Business for the Yakuza. Ikebukuro is ours.
It was 11 a.m. My husband and his men in the factory were taking a break. They were sitting down by the door to have a cigarette when a small man ran out from behind the cabinets and scared them all. My husband said the little man had long hair, was bald on top, wore a wine suit and was carrying a gun in each hand.
Residents of Grahamu believe the creature had entered the wrong building by mistake. It intended to enter this building, they say, right next door. There were supposedly six creatures in all, using this building as an operation space of some kind. This begs the question, what were they doing?
I believe the reason they were hiding in the disused building and the reason they were walking around Goryamu and the reason they needed so many guns was that they were planning a job. One morning, I saw two of them having an argument outside the building. The one in the white suit was arguing with the African one. "You are not among your subjects now," the one in the white suit was saying in a French accent. While they were arguing, I took out my phone and tried unsuccessfully to video them. The little guy in the white suit threw up his hands and walked away. He lit his cigarette as he walked and threw the empty packet on the ground. I noticed it was Chitan, the French brand.
We think they were arguing about which institution they should rob. There are 11 banks in Goryamu. They did not select the most lucrative target, by any means.
These little men were far from home. They were fish out of water. I truly believe they found the terrain puzzling. They tried to make sense of it. Some people say they gravitated towards things they identified with. I don't know. All I know is there are vaults that keep a lot more money than the Yamanuchi Bank. Given their expertise and all of that weaponry, they perform poorly.
It's not primarily a bank. It's mainly an institution for the acknowledgement of athletic achievement, and they even award grants. It doesn't have the best security. They don't expect to be robbed. There's grass and some trees.
It was a Wednesday night and we were finishing up here at the shop. We had been building clay suits all day and were covered in the stuff. We just wanted to get home and have a bath.
We saw the little men with guns running across the grass towards the bank. We saw them. Some of the security guards saw them, but you won't ever see them. We don't know why that is. You had to be there to see these little creatures. We don't know why. That's just the way it is.
I got into trouble for being in the library after I was meant to lock it up and go home. They were angry with me. I saw torchlight outside the sports office. I didn't think much about it.
They even set off the alarm.
Just before the sun came up and out the window, I saw a small helicopter landing on the grass and collecting little men. It looks like some children's TV program, but I called the police anyway.
Yes, let's see what the head office of the Tokyo police have to say. They might laugh off questions about strange creatures, but do they deny a break-in took place at the Yamanuchi Bank? Or did they perhaps investigate one? The man we need to speak to is in a different building. His name is Mr. Miyasaki, and these gentlemen will kindly write down his office address for us. Unfortunately, there are no functioning offices on floor 47 of the address we are given. When we eventually find Mr. Miyasaki's office, instead on floor 12, we are advised that he has been transferred across town to Otomachi. We ask what position Mr. Miyasaki holds in the Tokyo police, but his former colleagues do not seem to know. Whatever he does, he seems to move around a lot. Well, at the last building they showed me a map and they said I was to come to this building and that Mr. Miyazaki would be here.
No. Mr. Miyazaki is not here.
After hunting for 2 days, we finally locate Mr. Miyazaki having lunch. Excuse me, Mr. Miyazaki. Would you like to talk about the Yamanuchi bank robbery? You don't want to talk about the Yamanuchi bank robbery? Don't you think it's important that you said something about the Yamanuchi bank robbery?
Who you are?
You don't want us to talk about the Yamanuchi bank robbery?
I don't think those are very important.
You don't want to talk about the Yamanuchi bank robbery?
Forget about that.
Would any of you gentlemen like to say anything about the Yamanuchi bank robbery? You don't want to say anything about it?
No.
Hideo's job is to smooth out the wrinkles. It's not just the police who deny the whole thing. The media are just as blind or deaf to what people tell them. We were the only newspaper in Japan to print an interview with someone who saw a creature. After we printed the story, we noticed that sales dropped. Even our readers didn't believe it was true. We also seem to get less advertising, and our newspaper is alternative.
I saw a helicopter being flown by children wearing business suits. They nearly hit the bridge. We had a party here that night. I was heading home for a few hours sleep. When I saw the helicopter, I immediately knew something was wrong, because it was flying way too low, breaking the law. Then I noticed that it was a very old-fashioned helicopter. I knew it was going to crash, and I was moving from side to side. I was a bit scared, but it didn't. It was doing these weird circles. That was when I started trying to film it with my camera, which was hanging around my neck. I thought it was gone, but then it was still there. I stopped showing the tape to people. I know most people in this country don't believe me, but it's true. I know what I saw.
I work in an extremely noisy plant. Every morning, I walk to work the long way to prepare myself for being here all day. I take a lovely route along the canal. It is very peaceful. I even have a favorite spot where I normally pause for 5 minutes. When I don't have time to do this, I find the day is twice as long and stressful. I sit on the grass and stare at small boats while I eat my natto and drink my coffee. Unfortunately, that day, a helicopter had crashed into a wall and there were little wooden men in suits climbing out, very traumatized. One of them, bald, with long hair, couldn't find his asthma inhaler. A Frenchman was kicking the helicopter and saying that the police had shot the tank. "Where's Fenton?" they kept saying. "Where's Fenton?" Then the Frenchman sighed and said, "Moi à champ d'honneur." I did not know what it meant, but I always remember it. As I slowly backed away, the French one and the African one began having some kind of argument, something to do with a security guard. Then the man in charge, whom I have heard friends say was meant to be Moroccan, he told them all to shut up. I called an ambulance. I also told the story to my colleagues at work, but they said, "Michimo, you need to take a holiday."
It is the theory of local residents that things had not gone according to plan. The helicopter had failed to carry their supposed creatures even a quarter of a mile. An ambulance found a crash site, but authorities claimed there was no helicopter, rather a Toyota Sprinter wagon. The little people were now stuck in Guriamu, however, if we believe reports from outside a nearby school, from a shopping mall, from a unisex hair salon.
He was from some part of Africa, made of wood, I thought, the size of a little child. I am the guide, he said, the Jehovah, the navigator towards all greatness. Do not dare contradict me, for I am Balu Kutanga Nabibi, son of Watu Kutanga Nabibi, going from conquest to conquest, leaving weeping widows and fire in my wake. Sit down, I said, and he sat in the chair. He needed to be cleaned up. He looked like he'd been in some kind of accident. His hair was pointing up. A god such as I does not tolerate obstruction in any form, he continued. It must be exterminated. I said, yes, sir. I will be your loyal servant. Afterwards, I asked if he wanted the hair. He said I could keep it.
It was Thursday, the day the helicopter crashed, although I didn't know about that. I was returning from lunch with my boyfriend. He had called me at work and told me to meet him. We had a picnic in the park opposite his shop. My boyfriend was talking strangely to me, telling me how important I was, and then he asked me to marry him. I said that I would love to marry him. I was cycling on the pavement, which is quite normal in Japan, and was a little giddy because I had just gotten engaged when I saw one of the little men coming out of the hairdressers. He stepped into the street and was suddenly walking in my direction. He was African. He looked very unhappy about something. He was rubbing his head. I panicked. I turned into an alleyway and cycled really fast. My grandmother had visited our house the previous evening and talked to my mother about little men who were stalking people. I hadn't believed my grandmother at the time because she really is crazy, but now I knew she had been telling the truth and it was too much to take. I was very scared and felt stupid for turning into the alleyway. I felt sure the creature would follow me and kill me and nobody would see. I remember that I cried and touched my new ring for good luck. I prayed that the man wouldn't come and he didn't come. I realize now I was silly to be scared, but to this day children are still scared.
You see any puppets around? No? See any puppets around?
It was that lunchtime, Thursday lunchtime, and most classes were outside in the playground. I was sitting here at my desk, taking occasional glances at the poor quality screen behind me. There were many more children outside then, due to the fact that it was lunchtime. There were two teachers with them, as always. It wasn't possible to see anything on the screens, but we suspect the 5-year-old girl had a conversation with one of the creatures. That's what she said, anyway, and we chose to believe her. The girl said that the creature was wearing a white suit and that she liked him because he was the same height as her and because he looked like one of her dolls. The creature said it always surprised him when women found him attractive. Then he requested directions. She was only 4. She might not even know how to get to her own house, let alone give a stranger directions. Anyway, one of the staff discovered her, sitting on a swing, shaking, and took her into the school. She wasn't able to speak, which was strange for her. She's usually very talkative. She knew the difference between imagination and reality, but maybe this didn't fit into either category. She was fine, just in a bit of shock. To be safe, we laid her down for a while on a bed, and the school nurse took her temperature.
I was about to walk up my steps when I heard a rustling sound from behind the house, so I dumped my bags and decided to walk around the back and investigate. I was jet-lagged from my American flight and really wanted to go to bed, but I noticed that my golf balls had been knocked over, and as it wasn't even slightly windy, I became suspicious that an animal was somewhere about. I made a few sudden movements to try and scare the animal out of its hiding place, but nothing happened. It had been a rustling sound that I'd heard, so I decided to have a look in the bushes. I couldn't believe what I saw. There was a small man sitting on an old tricycle my son used to play with when he lived here. He was breathing desperately like he was having an asthma attack. I ran back to my bags and got my inhaler. He also asked for a toothbrush, and I took a brush from my bag and washed it and gave it to him. I don't know if I was washing it for him or for me. He thanked me, said goodbye, and climbed into the next garden. He seemed very sad. In the next house, they have many garden gnomes.
The homeless are outsiders in this society. So, they welcome other outsiders.
Japanese people are very proud, even the Japanese homeless. The creatures, we believe, were also quite proud. Yet both groups, proud though they were, had to be total outsiders. Japanese homeless are often friendlier to foreigners than normal Japanese people. Some of them keep pet rabbits. I heard that the Greek was literally given a place at the table. Greeks can be very proud, and many elderly homeless are like that too. They would rather go and make a house out of cardboard or whatever they can find. Some are mentally ill, it's true, but they are rarely drug users or lazy. They have self-respect. Often they have another house of bricks somewhere, but cannot provide money and therefore cannot face their wives. Try offering them change, and 9 times out of 10 they'll refuse it.
24時間営業で年中無休で
The community on Holmes Avenue, you might be surprised how respectable they are. They look out for one another. They have made that street into their home. Each of them has a sad story, but never a pathetic story. They are just people. Yukiko Maki is a woman who was arrested on suspicion of making a hole in her back door so that sounds from a portable stereo could reach her neighbour's house. Nobita is 25 years old. All we know about him is that, like 287 other Japanese children a day, he ran away from home when he was a child. Hideo Namata was a Japanese millionaire who made his fortune from 2 Takabashi department stores, but then lost everything on a chain of Michelin-starred restaurants in the 90s. Suzuki Ichiro worked for 31 years in a major pharmaceutical company, but was let go in the 90s. He didn't tell his wife for months, apparently, just pretended he was going to work every day, when really he was sitting in bookshops reading entire novels. Finally, the money ran out and he didn't return home. He never once talked with his wife about losing his job or leaving home. The tentos are well made, watertight, neat. The homeless air their futons, line their shoes up at the door, and use slippers inside. They are clean. A customer of mine glanced inside one tento on Holmes Avenue and saw a small kerosene stove, a small table with a radio on it, and the Greek creature reading a magazine.
The homeless love collecting things, so maybe he is hanging on the wall in one of their tents, or packed away in a box. Maybe they even made a little shrine and worship it. I don't know. In Japan, there are some sick people who beat the homeless up with baseball bats or set them on fire, but nobody goes near that particular tent village because legend has it that they have a small creature with a gun who protects them. So yes, perhaps he has been accepted into their community.
Yes, you hear a lot of stories about what happened to the creatures. Probably the most popular is the subway escalator story. Maybe because so many people saw the little man with long hair travelling on the Guriama line and thereabouts. I was one such person. For the first few stops, there wouldn't have been that many people on the train. An old man says that he saw him, says that he tried to reassure him and offer help. I got on the train then at Midodori. There was the little man sitting by himself, and I was shocked. I had heard plenty of silly talk about creatures the night before, but now here was one sitting right beside me. I don't really want to talk about it. It wasn't a pretty sight. He wasn't human, but he was in a lot of pain. I saw it happen. The little man fundamentally misinterpreted an escalator. He thought they were normal steps. When he realized they were moving, he became frightened, panicked, and tried to turn around. There were other people on the escalator, and some of these people tried to walk backwards then. Suddenly there was a lot of touching and struggling on the escalator, which is very uncommon in Tokyo. The creature's suit became stuck, and slowly he got sucked under and crushed, and the escalator started making a whining sound. Two people were treated for shock, and the station was closed down for 2 days. The media reported that a woman had gotten her dress caught in the escalator, but those of us who were there know the truth. We know that the people of Guriyama were not making it up. I don't know why the world does not believe us, but I do remember an old Oriental saying, attitude is the paintbrush of the mind. It's widely accepted within the community of believers that the saddest story is that of Noel Lamar, the Moroccan gang leader. Noel was believed to be carrying the proceeds from the bank robbery in a brown leather briefcase. He was last seen here in Mishimei, not just the largest shopping district in Japan, the largest shopping district in the world. Going to Mishimei makes me feel lightheaded, dizzy, and sometimes sick. Many Mishimei stores have cramped quarters and deliberately try to overload the senses. Some people call it store dazzle and have to run into a toy or bookshop to get some relief. It's estimated that every day 300 people get lost. Occasionally, some are never found. Like in 1975, the mother and 6 children who disappeared and were never seen again. A Japanese movie was made about that. Anything you want, you can find it in Mishimei. Triumph Tiger bikes, emergency lips, semiconductor holders, Dr. Phil's muscle massage system, OxyClean, footwear, smart shampoo, action figures. Many of our members corroborated that Noel was in Mishimei. When this became clear, about 2.5 to 3 months afterwards, I cried, getting lost in Mishimei. He was the one carrying money through Mishimei, a fish out of water. I have nightmares about it. Who knows what happened to him? One of our members is a well-known painter. He's working on a canvas entitled Noel Lamar Lost in Mishimei. Myself and the other managers in the Association of Mishimei Department Stores have publicly distanced ourselves from the Guriyama support groups and residents, indeed any groups or individuals, who subscribe to the notion of the puppets. There is not a shred of physical, photographic or video evidence to support the existence of a small puppet of Moroccan appearance with a briefcase, lost in our department stores, unable to find the exits, and getting under people's feet, as was unfortunately alleged by certain customers in our stores. The Association of Mishimei Department Stores believe this puppet never existed, and that repeated claims to the contrary constitute an elaborate, though unsuccessful hoax, designed by Guriyama residents as a publicity stunt to draw attention to the financial problems then faced by a local children's puppet theatre. The Association of Mishimei Department Stores accepts no responsibility for any anguish suffered by any individual as a result of said hoax. I used to be employed here. I lost my job when I refused to sign a letter that said things that weren't true. I was stacking miso right here when I heard a voice behind me. My friend, the voice said, where's the exit? The exit from the shop, I asked as I turned around, or to the street? I couldn't believe my eyes. It was tiny. The exit to the street, it said. Well, there's a door at the end of the aisle, I said, but it's locked. The little man started running, dodging past a big shopper with a quick dancing motion. I grabbed a throwaway camera, took it out of its packaging really quickly, and managed to get a photograph of him trying to open that door. For the love of Allah, he said, then started running back in the direction he'd come from. After he'd gone, a security guard came running past the miso, wanted to know everything. I explained it all to him, and he had no doubt at the time that it was true. It was only later the company decided it wasn't true. Many staff signed something which said they never saw anything, but a lot of us did. Many staff and customers saw the little Moroccan man.
I used to work here on the hair care aisle. I was showing a cushion-based brush. Myself and the woman were chatting away when we saw the little man running across the sub-concourse with a little briefcase. He was checking doors desperately. The security guard's door, the fire door. The doors were either locked or he couldn't reach the handles. I was still holding the brush just in case, although it would not have protected me much. The little man then seemed to be staring at two mannequins. I don't know why. Perhaps he was trying to talk to them. Then he was off again. He ran into a clothes shop. But I have no idea where he thought he was going. I think he was really lost.
He could see into their eyes and they could see into his eyes, I suppose. Dolls were smiling at him, people say. Perhaps the dolls understood him. Perhaps they wanted to help him find his way out of Mishime. It would have been difficult for him to know where to go.
I took a photo of him. One photo. By the meat.
We treated the little man just like a customer. One of our security guards offered to help, tried to give him directions. The little man said he needed to get back to Kumagai's World of Puppets. Unfortunately, our guard had never heard of such a place. So the little man with the briefcase was off again, running very fast for such a little guy. We saw him again about half an hour later. He was going in huge circles. I think he was scared of something, because every few seconds he would slow down and look behind him. We felt very guilty afterwards when we heard more about Kumagai's. I feel we did not help the little man. I always say that whatever a customer needs, I can provide, but don't think that was true in this case.
For a long time, we didn't talk to anyone about what happened, even our families. The people at Supermay told us not to. They said we would lose our jobs if we spoke to anyone about what we saw. My boyfriend saw him too. We used to be cleaners in Supermay. It was about 7 o'clock in the evening and we were just finished our shift. I was very tired and walking back to the dressing room to wash and change and then go out for a drink. I hated working there because the cleaning products smelled gentle but would make you feel dizzy. I got the feeling something was under my feet or behind me. I didn't pay attention, I thought I was just dizzy and didn't give it another thought. But boyfriend later told me he had chased the thing out.
I saw the little man near the storeroom. He was standing by the bananas with his little briefcase, just staring at the swinging storeroom doors. I think he was trying to figure out if he could get out that way. I tell myself he got out. Everyone says that he got trapped here in Mishimei, that the managers drowned him or something. I like to believe something different. I like to imagine that maybe he got out through a delivery entrance or something. I know this is unlikely. Children who had adults to take care of them have gone missing from that place, so it's unlikely our little friend would have gotten out alive, really.
The police, media, and government deny they ever existed. Yet it's clear they have left their mark upon the small community of Guriyamu. In Guriyamu Underground Station, a man sells a variety of robust house locks to protect you if the creatures ever return, he says. A local rock band performed an original song about a puppet trying to get back to his puppet theatre with desperately needed cash in order to save it from closure. A group calling itself Japanese Greens versus the Nuclear Mutants believes the creatures were mutants spawned by nuclear testing Japan has been carrying out in breach of Article 9 of the post-war constitution. The successful Guriyamu jazz musician Mikeo Usi has recorded a jazz track entitled The Little Men, which had been selling reasonably well, as all his records do. A freelance Japanese documentary maker has even shot a docudrama about the puppets, casting old Japanese daytime soap stars in the roles of the puppets.
You will find traces of puppets not only in Guriyamu, but Japan as a whole. There's a mental hospital near Kyoto, for instance, which has 14 patients who say they've experienced puppets. These are people who still wake in the middle of the night screaming about little men crawling all over them. There's a professor of psychology, Professor Tomita, who has gone out on a limb once or twice on television. Usually he'll be talking about something else and he'll make the connection with Guriyamu syndrome. He might be talking about cultural underpinnings of self-enhancement. He will sometimes say, a good example of this is Guriyamu syndrome. He rarely makes much sense. Neighborhood watch groups have always been very popular in Japan, and some of them have begun fearing the return of the creatures, as they call them. As far as one group near Guriyamu is concerned, there is a group of deformed wooden midgets on the loose in their neighborhood. Finally, some people have tried to sew or sculpt puppets. Sometimes the artists actually saw one of the puppets themselves. Sometimes they didn't, but believe others did. I never saw one of the puppets walking around Guriyamu myself, but I did used to go down to Kumagai's World of Puppets every weekend as a child, and to be brutally honest, I don't think that any of these amateur attempts have much likeness to what his beautiful little people looked like.
There is an assumption that in Guriyamu, we all believe in the creatures. A lot of us do. It's true. I do. But not all of us agree. I conducted my own survey very early on, before anyone remembered the puppet theater, and found that 30% of women and 27% of men believed terrestrial creatures visited Guriyamu, while 4% of women thought they were aliens, compared with 3% of men. 10% of Guriyamu women and 5% of Guriyamu men did not believe in the creatures at all. 8% of women believed it to be an elaborate hoax, and 20% of men believed this too. While 4% of women believed in Guriyamu syndrome, and so did exactly 6% of men.
A Japanese travel agency now offers a weekly Guriyamu creature tour, which takes Japanese tourists on a stroll around spots at which locals reported creatures. Local residents are protesting against this tour, however, because they claim it lampoons something deeply important to them. It's not unusual to encounter spots double-signed, one sign having been erected by residents and one by the travel agency. This is the GCESG, the Guriyamu Creature Encounter Support Group. Unlike the police, they will make you a cup of tea and take a detailed statement from you. Then, once a month, you will be invited to these gatherings where you can meet other Guriyamu residents who claim to have encountered creatures. What we're trying to do is pull together as a community. We have experienced something profound, of that there is no doubt. Whether it was magical or horrible, as one or two people have argued, one thing is indisputable. These encounters were very intense. They were dynamic. They were like nothing anybody has ever experienced before. Now, normally, when an event occurs that can be described in those terms, there is state recognition, support, there is media coverage. We have had to get by without any of that. The only thing we have gotten from wider Japan is laughter, some bullying. We have been treated very badly. As a result, one of our main priorities is going from door to door in Grahamu and making sure that we speak to literally every single resident. There may be an old woman, for example. She might not be very mobile. She might have encountered a creature and not been able to talk to anybody about it. She may have become super reclusive. We try to talk to every single individual in the community. When the person doesn't want to come to the door, we leave two things: some literature about the GCESG, and then the volunteer will also attach his or her card. This is effectively an invitation. The literature says, please come and join us. Tell us your story. Compare your story to that of your neighbors. We have gotten an incredible response. People will telephone us and sometimes be afraid. Afraid that if they talk about their encounter, they will lose their job or maybe their family will be angry with them. We try, in the first instance, to get them to come down to the office and make a statement about what happened. That's the first step. They are free to read other statements, although many statements do not have a name on them. 211 statements have been filed to date. This allows us to develop an idea of how many creatures there were and what their individual characters were. We believe there were six in total, one French and rude and wearing a white suit, who we have affectionately named Jean-Claude, one African who was stout and perhaps a dictator of a small country at one time in his life, based on the way he talks. We have come to call him Balou. When people make their statement, we know almost right away which creature they cross paths with. We will say, ah, Balou, and smile as we learn something new about the little guy, or, ah, Noel Lamar. Lamar, like I say, was the classiest and carrying the briefcase with the money from the bank. We think we know what the money was for now. We believe that one creature was shot by police at the bank, and that two were Greek cousins, one very neurotic with long hair and a bald head, and the other a bit sleazy and stinking of drink. We know they were all criminals. We have various theories, and we debate these theories. Young and old interpret things differently, and sometimes the young in our group understand more fluently. They first understood that the creatures were puppets. At other times, it's the old who seem to have the real conviction. Through this process of debate and storytelling, we are coming to terms with what happened. We are establishing a tradition. The young people here today will doubtless tell their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren, and maybe 200 years from now, old Japanese people will tell their grandchildren how, when they were young, their great-grandparent told them about the day they met one of the creatures as a child. This is really all we have. Oral tradition. Books are being written and you are making a film, but nothing can substitute those who bore living witness to this phenomenon. We are the ones who will speak against the doctors and psychologists and sociologists who call this some kind of mass hallucination or hysteria. Our stories, our existence, are the only real proof this ever really happened. Such solidarity has been key to the formation of the most popular theory of where the creatures came from, the aforementioned puppet theater theory. I subscribe to the idea that the creatures were really puppets from Kumagai's world of puppets. No one in Grahamu has any doubts that they were puppets from Kumagai's. Kumagai's world of puppets began entertaining Grahamu children in 1973. It came from humble beginnings. Kumagai sold vegetables and his first puppet shows were put on for young children who accompanied their parents to the market. In 1979, Kumagai bought the building next door and began putting on four shows a week, many of them derivative of popular children's movies, but occasionally he pushed the boundaries. I remember watching a puppet show of the American television series Dallas, in which the entire Ewing family had the heads of red setter dogs.
After every puppet show, Kumagai would invite a child on stage, hand them a puppet and do a demonstration. We loved this part because it made us feel that when we went home, maybe we could put on puppet shows too.
No, my favorite part was the beginning of the show, before the curtain was pulled aside. They had these amazing stars or leaves that used to fly past, and as a child they would fly past like they were flying. There was always a little gap on the right-hand side, and I remember always trying to look around it to see what was there. It was always a surprise, his show. Some shows were really normal, but sometimes he would surprise you.
He really would.
In the 80s, Kumagai built three more stories onto his theatre, and for a while he became quite well known outside Guriyamu. It wasn't just children who were coming to see his shows. Discerning adults would come from all over Japan to see something really scary or something really weird. There were hundreds of classic little puppet shows. That's all FUDGE 44 was at the time. A brilliant puppet show about two Japanese boys who invented the best ever recipe for fudge, who were being chased by a crew of multicultural assassins.
That puppet show was based on a true story. Two students here on the Transport Design degree course invented a recipe for fudge. They worked on it for years, since they were kids. Soon all the Japanese confectionery giants wanted to know the ingredients. The boys wouldn't tell them. They refused to sell out. About 2 weeks before the final exams, they just disappeared. We never saw them again. It's a mystery. We suspect they were kidnapped and tortured until they wrote down the recipe. Murdered. The story was not widely reported in the media, with the exception of Kumagai's World of Puppets, who decided to do a puppet show of the boy's life story. This is going back 20 years, before I was headmaster. The two boys were called Yasuo and Yoshiharu. They were very close because they'd both lost loved ones at a young age. Yasuo lost his older brother, who was more important to him than even his mother and father, who more or less raised him. The family spent a small fortune on private juku for the older brother to coach him for the rigorous entrance exams to university in Tokyo. If he passed, he would have been on the fast track to a high-flying career. But when the results arrived in the post, he had failed miserably. He didn't even tell his parents, just kissed Yasuo goodbye, picked up his study satchel, and went to the train station. He stood too close to the edge while many trains passed, then jumped. Yoshiharu, meanwhile, treasured 9 pet fish. He was closer to his fish than is normal for Japanese boys his age. Every day he brought a different one to school in a 5-liter mineral water canister, which was 4 times heavier than his school bag. I remember he used to place the canister on top of that shoe rack. His father, who drove a flour truck, thought the whole fish thing very unhealthy. Neither the fish nor Yoshiharu understood his hostility and ultimately just tended to ignore it. One day, Yoshiharu came home from school with the fish he had brought with him that morning to discover that all the others were dead. His father explained, one fish was enough. He had deliberately poisoned the rest by overfeeding them. So Yasuo was devastated by the suicide of his brother, and Yoshiharu by the murder of his fish.
Both the boys were lost. For a long time, neither of them talked to anyone. There was an understanding in school. Leave them alone. We were all very happy when they started hanging around together. We saw them talking a little in the playground. Then sometimes we noticed that they would walk home together. You wouldn't see Yasuo or Yoshiharu talking to anyone else or hanging around with anyone else. They always sat beside each other, always paired up together, perhaps because they were so disinterested in everything else. Kids in school and in the neighborhood looked up to them. We all thought they were so cool. Within a year, they had both grown their hair. They were the ones everyone admired. My friend and I fancied them. We used to follow them from school to the shop to the playground. We used to sit and watch them, and sometimes we were so in awe that we would even follow them around the playground. Sadly, I never became Yasuo's girlfriend. I don't think he liked me as much as I liked him. However, my friend in Yoshiharu, that was a mutual thing. He used to follow her home and spy on her and things like that. I was just a little more daring, that was all. I would wink at Yoshiharu, usually in the canteen. For weeks he was embarrassed and would just continue eating his fudge cake like he hadn't noticed. He loved fudge cakes. He used to bake them himself and bring plastic bags of them into school. He climbed the tree opposite my house. My father stared at him for a while, wondering what an 8-year-old boy was doing in a tree with a pair of toy binoculars looking in his daughter's window. When my father mentioned it at dinner, I immediately knew it was Yoshiharu. I asked him about it on Monday before classes, and he got really embarrassed. He denied being there, but I know it was him. I found a paper fudge cake holder on the road. We never kissed or anything. He was too shy. I think he was very sensitive. When I heard the two of them disappeared, I knew straight away it was their fudge recipe that had got them killed.
They spent a lot of time in this shop. They loved comics and would stand here for hours reading them. They also took a long time deciding what type of fudge to buy. They got pocket money once a week, I suppose, and wanted to spend it carefully. They spent a long time standing outside the shop exchanging fudge with one another. Doesn't seem like 20 years ago. Seems like yesterday morning. They were good boys. Wanted to own a fudge factory when they grew up. I was very sad when I heard they disappeared. But I never believed that they were killed by a group of multicultural assassins. That's not true.
When the boys were 11, something happened which changed everything. Yasuo's parents put him in high school a year earlier than Yoshiharu's. Suddenly, the two boys were in different places all day and only saw one another for an hour in the evening. Yasuo had fond memories of his brother playing baseball with him when he was little and was very eager to join the baseball team now that he was in high school. Some days he didn't see Yoshiharu at all and gradually they drifted apart. Yoshiharu sometimes saw Yasuo in the shop and noted that while he still read comic books, they were now strictly baseball related. Yoshiharu was very lonely. He felt as if Yasuo had abandoned him. He went into a dark place where he baked even more fudge.
It was very difficult for him. All he did during the last year in elementary school was eat and wait for the following year, when he would start high school and be reunited with Yasuo. Unfortunately, when he started high school, things with Yasuo did not suddenly go back to the way they had been. He tried to strike up conversations with him on the way to school, telling him jokes and stories, but while Yasuo listened, it was clear he found Yoshiharu boring. As soon as they arrived at school, Yasuo would just ignore Yoshiharu. The Japanese schoolyard can be a harsh place. Yasuo already had a group of friends, and one day when Yoshiharu got into a fight with one of them, Yasuo did not even intervene. He watched while his ex-best friend was beaten up. A teacher broke up the fight and gave out to Yasuo for not looking out for his friend. After a while, Yasuo started inviting Yoshiharu to hang around with him. But by then, Yoshiharu didn't care. He had come to prefer class time to break time. A few years passed and nothing changed. The students reached the age when they were allowed out of school during lunchtime and most went to the local park. Yasuo let Yoshiharu tag along for the sake of appearances, but once they arrived in the park, made Yasuo stand by himself, listening to his walkman. During this horrible time, Yoshiharu never hated Yasuo for what he was doing. He loved him. The situation in the park came to a head when Yoshiharu's little sister told the teacher what was going on, and the teacher actually came to the park and shouted at all the boys.
For 16 years, Yasuo's father had concealed from Yasuo and his mother the fact that he had never obtained a proper license of ownership from the Ministry of Land, Infrastructure and Transport. One day, Yasuo got home from school to discover the house being demolished. Half an hour later, the only thing remaining was one of his dead brother's shirts, which he had finally grown into and which had been drying in the sun after having the years washed out of it. Yasuo's family had no option but to move away from Goriyamu. Their new flat was a long way from Yasuo and Yoshiharo's high school, noisy at night and sometimes even a little dangerous. Some of Yasuo's friends were supportive, but none as much as his old friend Yoshiharo. Yoshiharo told him he was welcome to sleep over any time, knowing how long a journey he had to and from school. His home destroyed, Yasuo found warmth and comfort in the house of his old friend, and the two spent many an hour after school catching up. Yoshiharo was delighted. The two became obsessed with cycling, and Yoshiharo lost a lot of weight. It was just like old times. The only difference, joked Yoshiharo, is that we no longer want to run a fudge factory when we grow up. Yasuo told Yoshiharo that it was still his dream. Yoshiharo thought it over for a few weeks.
When Yasuo's father and I got divorced, Yoshiharo was once again there to comfort him. They spent all their spare time together. When Yoshiharo finished school, they moved in together and began working on what they claimed would be the best recipe ever for fudge. People soon began joking that they were gay, and it was Yoshiharo rather than Yasuo who uncharacteristically insisted they acquire separate apartments, separate cars, separate mailboxes, into which arrived separate rejections from the sweet-making school. They both reluctantly accepted their second preference, a degree in transport design. This was another defining moment in their relationship. Yoshiharo now became slightly dismissive of Yasuo, blaming the whole sweet-making debacle on him and sometimes even ignoring him in the university canteen. Their childhood dream to make fudge became smothered under the weight of their transport design curriculum. They once again drifted apart. They rarely saw one another. One day they were both sitting at separate tables in a coffee shop when a small explosion occurred in the kitchens trying to make their fudge. It piqued the interest of the latent sweet-maker Yasuo, but Yoshiharo barely even noticed. However, as they got on with their individual lives, strange things would tie them together. For instance, Yasuo once told me that he had started going out with a girl only to discover that the girl worked with another girl who was dating Yoshiharo. Apparently, they were employed in the same cake shop. My son in particular found this very annoying and believed that the girls are part of a plot to try and discover their successful recipe for fudge. There was a lot of people who wanted to know the recipe, but the boys wouldn't tell. It didn't surprise me when both boys suddenly disappeared on the same day. A mother understands. They refused to hand over the recipe because they wanted to protect their childhood. Yasuo would never get over his brother's death, and Yoshiharo never forgave his father for the fish incident. Even when his father got old and sick, Yoshiharo couldn't bring himself to hug him. Things happen to us when we are very young, and that's it. It's who we are. Forever.
Fudge 44 was a great puppet show. It showed Yasuo and Yoshiharo growing up and making fudge in their bedrooms. It was fiction, obviously, because, I mean, nobody knows what happened to Yasuo and Yoshiharo. Maybe they ran away. We can only wonder. In the puppet show, they had these six assassins trying to kill the boys. A Greek, a Frenchman, a Moroccan, etc. Lots of action. I saw Fudge 44 three times. It was the best puppet show Kumagai ever did. He put his soul into it. When we heard about those creatures running around Goriyamu, well...
They were the assassins from Fudge 44. It was a great puppet show. There were six of them hunting Yasuo and Yoshiharo trying to get the recipe for fudge. The criminals, or assassins, were very amusing, very entertaining. They never actually caught Yasuo or Yoshiharo. The puppet show had a fairy tale ending. When the puppets came to life in Goriyamu, when the GCESG started taking statements and descriptions, we all wondered, what the hell is going on? The thing is, in the 90s, it emerged that Kumagai had never paid any tax. He had got letters, and then he got listed in the paper, and they shut him down. He either came up with the money that he owed, or they would eventually sell his puppet theatre. He tried to raise the money for years. He did puppet shows on steps. Eventually, he just stopped coming out of the theater.
Hello? Is there a Mr. Kumagai here? According to this note, Kumagai now lives above a nearby fabric store. Strange little men have always appeared to Japanese people. It was reflected in Japanese mythology, where the gods would leap down to human level. They would display human emotions, such as love and anger, in order to demonstrate to the humans what it felt like to be in their position. Everyone in Guriyamu thinks that the creatures were puppets from Kumagai's. I guess the assassins from Fudge 44 were the most qualified of all the puppets to rob a bank. Our forefathers believed it was a last-ditch attempt by the gods to rescue a lost cause. When creatures visited, it usually meant that something awful was going to happen. Sometimes, our people paid attention to the little show. Other times, they dismissed it as superstition and said people were seeing things. This is how Japan reacted to the puppets of Guriyamu. We ignored them, and Kumagai's world of puppets was closed down as a result. Perhaps if that Moroccan puppet had made it back to the theater with the briefcase full of cash, maybe Kumagai's would not have been demolished. We'll never know. Maybe he'd still be entertaining children today. Does Mr. Kumagai work here? Mr. Kumagai?
Kumagai?
Yeah. Mr. Kumagai? From Kumagai's World of Puppets?
No.
This was as close as we got. In the background, it was possible to catch a brief glimpse of Mr. Kumagai.
Of the city of engineers, la 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 la.